Thank you very much for joining, Sunil. Good morning, everyone. Thanks for joining for this call, which is the next in the what I call the Emerging Future series. This is a series to try and catalog the lives and stories of people whom I've known, who touched my lives, and who really had a public life where they've been quite influential in their own rights. And my guest today is someone whom I'm sure you've all seen at prime time on television in your living rooms. It's a good friend, a close friend who's been there, done it all, seen it all, and now continuing in the same vein. The guest is Sunil Alagh, eminent TV personality and a business leader in his own right. Sunil has been involved with creating some of the most iconic brands in the country. He's had his fair share of upheavals in his life also, and he's going to speak of his personal journey, challenges, and learnings along the way. Of course, he's going to be joined by his lovely wife, Maya Alagh, who's a doctor, who's been a model and in movies also, and she'll share her perspective and her story. This session, like the earlier sessions, is going to be recorded, and I look forward to you posting your questions in the chat box so that we can share your questions also with Maya and Sunil. So with this, I come over to you, Sunil. Sunil, how's everything with you? How's been the lockdown? And would love to hear your story now and how you've come to this stage.
You know, I mean, I just want to begin by saying that don't expect any great thought-provoking chat from me, as you heard from Deepak Jain and everybody else that you've been showing so far. You know, because I'm a Punjabi, and that's either you never leave a Punjabi with a thought. That's what I've learned. And because if you leave a Punjabi with a thought, when you see him the next time, he's going to give it back to you. We are just men of action, so don't expect any thought-provoking thing. And also, I've got to say two prayers of forgiveness as soon as I've heard you. One is a prayer of forgiveness for you for having said so many lies about praising me. And the second is for myself because I really enjoyed it. That's the most important. But, let me try and, it's very difficult for me to go back all the time, but nothing in my life was planned. Huh? This is what I want to share with everybody is that right from the beginning, everything that happened to me happened because I was not expecting it. And then when it happened, I didn't know what to do with it, but I moved on. And therefore, that's my entire life. But today, when I look back, maybe I can tell you all what really happened and at least help you all plan your lives. But I didn't plan my life at all. Okay. So I want to start from my school days, really, because I was perhaps the shortest guy in class, so I had to sit in the first row. We went by height rather than by any intellect or intelligence. And the last row in Calcutta was taken up by what I would consider the first generation Anglo-Indians. What I mean by the first generation, I meant either the mother was English or the father was English. That's when we had the first generation. So, but they had a particular approach to life, which was amazing, absolutely amazing. And I learned a lot from, especially from a gentleman called Vincent Hyde. I don't know where he is. I remember that name even now because he sat in the last row and he had a Brad Pitt look. He was blonde haired, blue eyed, very gora. And he was just, and he was tall and he was brilliant in whatever he did, except in his studies, of course. But no Anglo-Indian was really interested in studying. They went to school. And you learned a lot from them. So what I would like to come up and say is that, look, right from the beginning, what did I learn from Vincent Hyde was that my parents told me that, look, you are going to get 5 rupees a month. And at that time, to see, I love movies. So 1 rupee four annas at that time was a stall ticket. Okay, so you got it for 4 weeks, 1 week a movie, one movie a week, and then you went and saw it. And as long as I came in the first 5 in class, that was the limitation that my parents put to me. And I always came 4th, 5th, but never first. So my mother once asked me was that, look, why don't you try and come first? Because even though your first five is okay, because I said, look, if I come first, then I will never have time to go and see a movie. And that is the only reason why I always came fourth or fifth, a good little, knowledge and logic that I followed. But once in my life, in my entire life, I came, I think, 18th in class, 1-8, and only once. So I was really scared of going home. You know, what happens in most Indian homes are that your mother and your father will, at that time, of course, you were allowed to whack. My mother kept whacking me completely, but my father perhaps raised his hand on me only twice in my entire lifetime. But my mother's whacking was general, you know, a good whack was there. So at the end of, it was, I think, early May when the report card was given. And when schools opened, your summer holidays started. And then when schools opened in June, that's when you took the signature of your parents and you went with your report card. So I decided there's no point. I'm going to get a bamboo in any case. But tell your parents that this time the report card is coming when you go on the first day in school. Because this way, I looked at it that if you told them on the 1st of May, your holidays were spoiled. If you tell them at the end of your holidays, you're going to get the same bamboo, but at least enjoy your holidays. But I come back to what Vincent Hyde told me at that time. He said, look, if you've got a problem because you've come 18th, come to my house first. So straight from school, at that time, there were landlines available, not mobile. So I rang up my mother and his house was not too far. I said, I'm going to have tea with him. And I went and had tea with him. And he always came 22nd in class out of 25. At that time, we never had more than 25 kids in class. On that occasion, he came 20th. So he went to the house and he showed his parents the report card. And the father jumped up in joy. He called the mother out and there was great celebration. Look at what your son has done. He's now come 20th. And they danced and they sang and you had tea and you had cakes. And I was admiring the approach to life that was taken by the Anglo-Indians at that time. And I said, look, I wish if my parents took that same approach, but then I came home. And at that time, I'll tell you, in school, we used to have, I don't know whether they still have it or not, but once a week, and I was in a Christian Brothers school. Okay, very few Christian Brothers school were there. There were only three at that time. The Calcutta, we had St. Joseph's, and then we had St. Patrick's in Asansol and St. Columbus in Delhi. They were run by Irish brothers and not by fathers. And we used to have a class once a week called moral science class. I don't know where that is gone now, but moral science was very important.
Yeah, even we had it in school.
Yeah. Very long. So on that day, the Christian brother told us about circumcision. I'm just giving you an example. And then he said, nothing to worry about. This is what happens. Some people do it for health. Some people do it for religion. And, you know, we understood circumcision in school. Of course, it was only in the last 1 or 2 years before senior Cambridge that this kind of discussion took place. But one Bengali boy, and I remember him quite clearly, was a gentleman called Prosoon Das. These are two names that have stuck in my head all along. He was completely foxed by what had he learned, you know, about circumcision. So during lunchtime, he was sitting quite confused. And I told Vincent Hyde, I said, listen, he hasn't understood what the Christian brother was trying to say. So Vincent Hyde told Prasoon Das, and I still remember very clearly, he said, listen, circumcision means you just toodle the noodle. And I learned how to, in advertising, how do you say in three words what was said to us in half an hour? And that's another learning I took, was toodle the noodle. And that's what stuck in my head, that in 30 seconds in all your ads, you have to communicate. You don't have time like a movie where you have 2 hours, but this was the most important. And on another occasion, on one of the moral science classes, I only remember two of them very clearly, was when the Christian brother told us about sex. And he said, look, you have to have sex to procreate. He was not talking about sex as we understood, but he said, look, everybody, your parents or anyone, will have to have sex because to procreate. Prasoon Das was in total depression because he was refusing to go home. See, what had happened in all our homes, and I want all of you all to recall that, is that sex was bad. Huh? Everyone, our parents told us, sex, the moment you took the word in, it meant it was, you were committing sin. It was the worst word. And here was Prasoon Das, who was told that, look, his parents had sex. Now, he was totally confused because he thought his parents were like God and they were saying sex is bad. How could they have indulged in it? So he was literally not going home because he was so depressed. Here again, we go to Vincent Hyde and we told him, Prasoon Das is not going home. So he said, wait a minute. And he explained to Prasoon, he said, look, you're damn lucky because my mother is having sex with everybody. My father is having sex with everybody. Whether they were having or not was besides the point. But he told them, but he said, your parents had sex only once to produce someone like you. Please remember that. Now, psychologists could not have explained to Prasoon Das what Vincent Hyde did in a few minutes when he told him that, look, your parents have indulged in the act to produce someone as good as you. Now, I mean, I just remember these and I just wanted to share this with you. And then, of course, you go on and you say that, look, in college days, now you move on to college. And at that time, my father told me, I've been giving you 5 rupees a month. Now, you are going to get 100 rupees a month in college. Suddenly, from 5 rupees, I went to 100 rupees. And I told my father, 100 bucks. At that time, 100 rupees was quite a lot. Huh? I mean, that's not what it is today. So I told him, I said, you're giving me 100 rupees a month now. He's saying, yes, because you're going into college now. And this is it. Now, I had two friends and we all sat together for some reason. I'd never met them before. I was in St. Xavier's College in Calcutta. And Avik Sarkar, who was the Ananda Bazar Patrika guy, he was the upper income group guy. He only came to work in a car and he came to college in a car, and we used to admire one guy coming in a car meant solid amount. And the other boy was Shamul Datta, who was the poorest. He was the son of a sergeant. And a sergeant in that time in the police was someone who is just one level above a corporal. He has a mobike.
Yeah.
But that's, I don't know what the rate is in police, but that's it. So he was staying in a 250 square feet flat. I was staying in a 1,000 square feet flat, and Avik Sarkar was staying in a bungalow. Now, that is, therefore, you had the upper income group, the middle income group, and the lower income group, all three together. Why did we sit together? I have no idea. But somehow, the three of us sat together, and we lived off each other. I will say, when we lived off each other, and we are still, till now, I mean, it's been 50 years, it's the only three friends that I have to date. One person was Shamol, who went on to become the IG of police. Let me tell you what he achieved. I went on to become the MD of Britannia, and Avik went on to head Ananda Bazaar. So all three of us achieved in our lives what we set out to achieve. Therefore, it taught me that it doesn't matter what level of income you come from and from wherever you come. If you set your mind and you have good friends around you, you will. Now, what Shamol was to you, took copious notes in college. Every time a professor spoke, so we all, and I would look at the ceiling because Shamol was taking notes. Avik would arrive with the latest books that were there because his father could import them. And he would come with the textbooks, which I couldn't afford. Whereas I, at home, my mother, somehow Avik as well as Shamol came to my house because they felt so warm that they felt that the warmth of the home was the most important. So all three of us would study whilst my mother made tea or coffee and pakoras and everything else. So the richest guy, the poorest guy didn't make a damn difference in our lives. Huh? We are still the best of friends. We've all achieved. That's one thing I want to share with all of you all. And Avik once went abroad. At that time, going abroad was like whatever. And he came back with a lot of gifts for me. There was an aftershave. There was a belt. I was thrilled. And I went home and I told my mother that, look, this is what Avik has got for me. And my mother said, you will return everything. I was shocked. I told my mom, you want me to return everything? But why? She's saying, can you return to Avik what he is giving you? And we are not in that income group at all. So please do not accept gifts which you cannot return, you know. And I, with a heavy heart, went back, but I kept one aftershave quietly. I told Avik that I'm returning everything to you because my mother said it, but I hope you don't mind this aftershave I need for all the women that I meet. So I'm keeping this aftershave without my mother knowing. But Avik Sarkar taught me yet another lesson. He said, listen, Sunil, I want you to keep all of it. And please go and tell your mother that 100 rupees for me is equal to 10 rupees to you. If you sacrifice 10 rupees and give me a gift, it is the same as me sacrificing 100 rupees. And that's a massive lesson which we have continued even till now, because when we go to a restaurant, Avik will even now order the best of wines and the best of champagne, which I could never afford. So when he was hosting a lunch or a dinner, you just kept quiet and had the best. When you ordered and when you were hosting, Avik would never ever ask for the same wine or the same, he left it to you. Now that's a very big lesson that he has told me, that learn to sacrifice. As long as the sacrifice is equal, whether it's Shamol, yes, or whether it's me or whether it's Avik, do not value in money terms. Okay, that's something that Avik has taught me, and I still remember that, and it stayed. That's why we are still good friends. Now let me come along to when I finished college. I went to IIM. Why did I go to IIM? I got admission in St. Stephen's in Delhi. And I was then turning around and saying, I didn't like maths, I didn't like science. So you either became an engineer or a doctor or a chartered accountant at that time. These are the three options. So I was just in arts and economics and everything else. And I said, look, now what do I do with my life? I finished college. Mm-hmm. And my father, who ran a motor parts shop, he never had any manufacturing at all. He just ran a dealership. Okay. When he came in from the partition days, he ran a small little shop. He said, listen, if you come into my business, I will set up manufacturing of just a particular part. But if you're not coming into the business, I was the only son. Huh? And my mother, I've got to thank, they're not alive today. And they said, you leave the boy and let him pick what he wants to do. So I went to the shop for 3 days. I didn't like that idea of selling motor parts. And I came away and I told my dad, I am not going to be in the business. And they accepted it. They then said, my father was not very rich. He said, look, I want to give you the best education. That's all that I can afford. And after that, it's up to you. So IIM was the next option because it had just started at that time, a couple of years ago. And I went and I sat for an exam. You know, that was the first time when you had all these exams which you just marked off yes or no, yes or no. You had never, otherwise you wrote a hell of a lot. So I went and sat for it. And you will not believe it that after I was called for the interview in IIM, another thing I learned was my surname, which was Alag. Remember that when you go into an interview, don't ever think that the person has endless time, because a lot of people are going to come after you. Okay. Therefore, he's got maximum 10 minutes or 15 minutes at that time. Of course, when you become a senior position, at that time they want to see and they go through your bio data. But that time you're just getting into IIM. No? So what I did was, I said, okay, now they've got 10 minutes or 15 minutes with me. And the moment they saw my name was Alag, they wanted to know that was a very unusual name. So that has helped me a lot. So I took 10 minutes to explain to them that I have no idea, but my brother, who's Dr. Yugender Alag, is doing some research. Perhaps at that time in Pakistan, maybe we were all thieves and crooks and we were shunted out from the village. So you went and stayed because there are very few Alags. And you went out and that was it. Or you're from Genghis Khan's family. And let me tell you, my brother has now found out, when he was a minister, he went to Mongolia and he found a small place called Alag, spelled A-L-A-G-H. And then he went and asked them why. In Alag meant kind of a general. It meant a sir in Mongolia. So it's possible because Genghis Khan at that time came to the borders of what we call Pakistan and all today. And therefore, I gave a full story. The blighters had only 2 or 3 minutes left after they were quite fascinated. So I went through. But the story that I want to tell you is that I was 11th in the waiting list to join IIM. 10 people that year never turned up. So when God is on your side, another saying that, look, do not think that because you are 11th or 10th or if anyone comes along, you went in. Now, and yet, I was 11th on the waiting list. But when I finished 2 years, I was 6th in class, cumulative average. Huh? So therefore, it does not say that what happens in the beginning, that's the way you're going to end. Opportunities will come way beyond what you think. Just wait. Just be patient. And if there is a, I don't mean God, any supreme being, then there is an opportunity there. Just relax and something will happen. But then after that, I got a job in ITC. I went on. And today when people turn around and say, you have to use influence, neither my father knew anyone, nor anybody in my family knew anyone. I got the job. That's it. You be yourself. And if you're good, then that's what happens in life. So anyway, I went along. And then when...
Tell us about your Britannia times.
Then when I joined Britannia after ITC 4 years later, I joined Britannia and my first battle took place with Rajan Pillay. Okay. And that was there when Rajan Pillay was a guy who really made me. He's the one who made me MD at the age of 39 or 40. I was the youngest director. And to be a multinational MD, that time Britannia was multinational, if you remember, was at the age of 39 was unheard of. Okay. So I joined that. So suddenly I had to lead a very dual life. One was you met MDs like Keki Dadi Seth and all at work. And all your friends were general manager marketing whom you enjoyed yourselves in life. So you had to be young enough to be there and old enough to look intelligent and sound intelligent. So I went through all that. But with Pillay, and he and I had a great session. About 10 years later, I think his wife brought in her brother into the company. And then he formed his own group. Okay. And I said that, look, the accounts manager of exports, he was busy exporting to Rajan Pillay without an LC. And the rule of the company was no exports were to go without an LC.
Okay.
So when I discovered that that was happening, I went to Rajan and I told him, I said, Rajan, your brother is doing this. I called the brother up. You have to take permission for all this. Of course, Rajan didn't like it. And that's when my first sack took place. And when I was sacked, I came home and I said, this is what it is. What should I do? And Rajan offered me, please believe, 5 years of salary, a transfer to Singapore, so no tax would have to be paid for 5 years, okay? Plus the house that I was staying in Bombay was also given. So I said, wow, that's a terrific, gift which could come across. And I went home and I spoke to my wife. She'll talk about it as well, Maya. And she said, you will not accept it. I go back to my mother saying, don't accept a gift. And here was Maya saying, don't accept it. Because the moment you resign from a company, all the blame will come on you. It is better to be sacked and say you're getting sacked for this reason. And that's when Dannon was in the picture and Antoine Ribou called me to Paris. And he said, get sacked. Don't worry. So we both went across and we said, what happens if we're going to fight for Britannia. If we get Britannia, you're back. If you don't get Britannia, you get a posting in any one of the countries that Dannon is, and you will be the one person. So that's when I went. Now, the question that I asked myself, if it wasn't for the family, if it wasn't for the children, if it wasn't for Maya and my friends who really stood by me, few friends, but they said, do not. I was a greedy Punjabi young guy, 5 years salary, ye wo, wapis aake dusri job le lenge. Kya farak padta hai? But they stood by me, and that was the first time. Okay. After that came the Dannon thing and Antoine Ribou. One nugget I'm going to give you: when we talked to Antoine Ribou, I talked to a number of people and I've got tired of listening to people who say, work hard, be honest, this, that crap. I've never followed any of that. You ask all the big guys a particular nugget from besides saying what, being honest and hardworking and all that. What else can you say? And he told me, never in French, and I'm using the word, never fuck a mosquito. And he told me in French, and I'm just translating it for you because it's so small, you will never get an opportunity to do it. And it's going to buzz around you all the time and it's going to keep biting you all over the place. So never ever try and do that. And that's the learning I got from him in French. Okay. And I've kept it all my life because, I like Hindi movies. Okay. And therefore, and I also like cartoons. And today when people ask me, what do you do in your hobby? That's what I do. And what have they taught me? Please understand. Hindi movies and Cartoon Network. I enjoyed Tom and Jerry in school. I still do. And my favorite cartoon now is Charlie Brown. Okay. Schultz is an outstanding guy. But every time, what do you learn? And I've gone to a number of places and I said, never be a Jerry or never be a Tom. Because Jerry, one thing is clear. Tom never gets Jerry. And I thought of what Antoine Ribou taught me. He'll keep chasing. You'll be a source of entertainment. So never be a Tom in your life. Look for someone and do not chase unimportant things in your life, which most of us do. And Hindi movies, what did it teach me? Nothing is impossible. Everybody keeps saying, but Hindi movies teach you that. The weakest guy beats the strongest guy in the end. The poorest guy gets the richest girl. That's what I learned from Hindi movies. Nothing is impossible. never ever get into thinking that either Hindi movies or cartoons don't teach you something. Charlie Brown is one of the most philosophical ones. And I use that cartoon, one cartoon I use in all the things that I go where Snoopy is lying and Lucy comes across and tells Snoopy, what made you a dog? You know, because, and she's saying it with a great deal of sarcasm and, you know, Lucy is going there. And Snoopy thinks and he says, I was fooled by the job description. Brilliant cartoon. Absolutely brilliant. And that's what all of us go through life. And look, that's the most important. Then, of course, came Nasli in my life.
Yes.
Which I'm sure all of you want to hear. For 9 or 10 years, we had a terrific relationship. Every time he rang me up, and I was in Bangalore and he was in Bombay, and we all had a fabulous relationship. In the 10th year, I made the mistake, in hindsight, when he asked me, he wanted to put both his sons on the board. And I said, no way. This is the first time I'm telling all of you all this. It's not recorded anywhere, not told to anybody. And I said, no way, because let's not destroy the professionalism of the organization by putting two people who've just finished school. They never even went to college, by the way, ever. So by putting them on the board, it's going to be dangerous. Put them in the middle management. And I give the example of Rajiv Bajaj and all. They've all went to the shop floor first. But I will personally fast track them so that in another couple of years, when the team is ready, they all know that you're the owner's son or semi-owner at that time. Mm-hmm. But, and that time he agreed and he listened. But Nasli, I've got to remember, never forgets. Never ever forgets. After that, he started going after me in the sense minor things started happening. Again, I felt, one thing I felt was, look, I got him Britannia. Mm-hmm. I got him so many things. I have taken the company from 250 crores when it was to 1500 crores. I have built the company, I've built the brand, I've launched Tiger for him, I've done everything. Why on earth will he attack me? You know, this why, and this is the problem that we all face, is because we watch him doing many things to other people, but we say, ha, theek hai, it won't happen to me. That's the whole thing, because I've done so much for the man. And yet he did it, and therefore there were two things then. He actually audited all my accounts for 7 months. He said, I've misused my position. And he's gone to the media everywhere. The media lasted for only 2 or 3 days, only because I kept quiet. Remember one thing in life, that media always wants you to react. The moment you react, your story goes on for another 1 month. And the more you will react, the more he'll react, he'll go on for another 3 months. After all, if you keep quiet and all your friends know, what I did was, like Deepak Jain at that time, go to only like Hemendra Kothari, and Deepak Parekh and Sushin Datta at that time, and tell them, Gautam Singhania, tell them what actually happened. And by word of mouth, they will back you to the hilt. That's the way. But don't go to the media at all. Speak to a few people who matter and tell them that you are perfectly okay. And I went through that same kind of procedure when he did it. But the problem with me was that at that time, unlike the Pillay time when I was young, and I felt I could come up. This time I felt, okay, what the hell is happening to me? Yeah. I came home and I told everybody, this is what is happening. Now what do I do? At my age, nobody is going to recruit me. Nobody is going to happen. This is the end of the world. So I went at that time, suddenly 2 or 3 friends arrived, like Hemendra Kothari and everybody else. And what Nasli did at that time, he wanted for 10 years, he did an audit. And he said, for 10 years, you owe me 1 crore and 10 lakhs. 1 crore and 10 lakhs for 10 years meant about 10 lakhs a year. Look at it for, people think at all in 1 year, 10 lakhs a year. And he went to such small things like my maid in my guest house. She said, you know, I used to just have my breakfast in the morning. Lunch was in the office. Dinner was always out in Bangalore. But he said she was earning 500 rupees a month, which was for her lunch and her whatever she wanted to eat, which worked out to 6,000 rupees a year, and multiplied by 10, 60,000 rupees, you pay. Now, I mean, because he could find nothing. Every single paper that I had signed was found and detected. And then they came up with all this and they said, you entertained. Please tell me 10 years ago in your entertainment, who was your official friend? Who was your private friend? So he went into a total mess. But one thing, as a message I want to give everybody, remember that I came across and said, look, if there's a superior being, never attack someone who's stronger than you, because he's going to kill you. Why is he slapping the shit out of you? It's because you're weaker. Remember one thing, sooner or later, the balance will be found. today Ratan Tata is doing for me what I wanted to do to Nasli. He's going after Nasli. There will always be someone bigger. You move on with your life.
True.
And that is what I did. And they said, look, and Hemendra Kothari and all that, do not file a case because you'll win the case, but nobody will touch you. Because, I mean, what did I do wrong at that time? Nothing. Salaries were low. These were the unwritten perks. All MDs, Nestle would have all been screwed if I had gone to court. But for 10 years in court. So what they said was, how much is he taking? 1 crore 10. Then I discovered 1 crore 10 or 20 was equal to my provident fund, which he had to give, and he wanted that money back. That's how he came to that total. But at the end of it, what do you learn from it? I just want to say, what did I learn was, they said 1 crore 10 lakh de do. You will earn it in the next 3 months, they guaranteed. And along came Warburg Pincus. I said, 1 crore 10 lakhs in 3 months? Kya baat kar rahe ho? Along came Warburg Pincus, which was the bluest of bluest funds in that time. They recruited me and they paid me 1 crore a year for just being their advisor. Kiran Mazumdar arrived and she said, look, I want you to come to Biocon. I've been a B2B kind of business. I want to set up my own. Will you come and advise me? I said, pharmaceuticals? And that's where I started with. Even Nikhil Joshi was one of my first people who came along and said, I want you to advise me on tea. So suddenly a new business arrives from the kind of business I've been leading into being a consultant. And money was flowing in at that time. I was earning much more. I said, why didn't I start this 5 years ago? Mm-hmm. But that's how you are. So new businesses will come when you least expect it. Deepak Jain forgot to tell you one thing. He told me that when I asked him, I said, when I was in Kellogg's, I asked him, give me one learning. And he said, remember that whenever you are taking a flight, okay, the person sitting next to you has been sent by someone, even though you don't know him. Talk to him. 5% of the time that guy will look at you and not talk back, fine. 95% of the time he will start talking back. And remember that. And that's what happened with a few of my friends. They came out of the woodwork. They helped me stand up and my consulting began. Okay, that's one thing which you have to learn and learn all the time, you know, and that's very, very important. One other thing I've learned is 3 R's in my life. Okay, the 3 R's are, you know, renovate, innovate, and profit. Otherwise, you're RIP. That's the way I came into RIP was, for me, was not 3 R's. It was RIP, renovate, innovate, and profit. So anyone who comes up with an idea which cannot be commercialized in Britannia, I used to say, forget it. Because you might come up with the best biscuit which nobody can afford. That doesn't help me. It has to be sustainable. Absolutely. And it has to be commercialized. And that's how I came up with Tiger at that time. So we go on with our lives and turn around and say, okay, what do you carry on learning, you know? And remember, in every meeting, because I was incapable of thinking so much, every meeting that you have, write down what you want to achieve in the meeting in the office before you start or when you meet someone. Come away and say, did you achieve that? And it's very, very important because all of us can continue having meetings. Every meeting must have a decision maker. That's what I've learned. Without a decision maker in each meeting, and no matter how small the issue is, learn from them. And I, you know, another one of the sayings that I have to say, I have learned very hard, is that, look, you must learn to, a wise man, if you ask me, really, and I learn from others' experiences. That's what I think. I learn from others' experience. You know, an ordinary person learns from his own, and a fool never learns. So I have never learned from my own experience. I've always looked around and said, okay, if you got a good idea, let me see how I can copy it and how I can. Don't be, of course, don't get into the area of somebody's, you know, patented
intellectual property. Yeah,
but I just say, look, that's what I've told everybody. I said, look at what Japan did when I was growing up. It was, you know, Holland was the best for electronics. Japanese came along and then you had Sony and you had everybody else who said, sold it cheaper in the beginning. But after that, they superseded them.
True.
After that came the South Koreans. It's the LG and Samsung who superseded the Japs. And now Chinese, higher has come in.
In fact, some questions have started coming in. In fact, some very nice
questions.
And,
you know, go ahead.
Some of your fans complimenting you on your Punjabiyat. And they say that, you know, you're a true Punjabi and you celebrate that. That's being appreciated. Another question that is coming through is, you built a very successful Tiger brand. Can you tell about the story of it, and also what is your lesson on how to build good brands and products, services, and even personalities? You've done a lot of that.
Yeah. You know, I'll quickly tell you about Tiger. Most people think that, you know, the Tiger thought came to me all along when Parle G was the number one and I was in Britannia. And I was always saying, what can we do? Give them vitamin D in it, charge the same price, consumers will come to you. So we tried everything at that time. But every time the dealer would turn around and say, buzz off, Parle G is the best, glucose is the best. So I tried for I don't know how many years. But during the 9 months, during that Pillay era when I was out before I came back, you have to ask yourself when you stand back and say, what would you do differently? What would you do if you ever went back? I didn't know I would go back to Britannia. And then you realize that if it's intuition that, look, if you keep calling your product glucose, you're always going to be compared to Parle G. So how do you break that becomes very important. So ultimately, I said, call it Tiger. It's the same biscuit as glucose. No change in recipe. But you call it Tiger and don't waste your money on research because you're putting your... Be a risk taker there. So I called it Tiger because every mother wanted their child to be a Tiger. Every kid wanted to be a Tiger. So what were you going to research? Was the brand name okay? Of course it was okay. Then I said that on the shelf, all products were in white. If you notice the glucose products and that. I said, put a red pack on ours. Why red? Because red is a good color. Yaar. Sindoor lagate hai. It's always used for shubh log. Lal karo. Why do you need to research? Put red. I was fought tooth and nail by my team who said, red, sir, look like Lifebuoy soap. It'll look like X. Don't make your pack red. But it worked wonders because you never put your product next to Lifebuoy soap. You put it amongst the glucose biscuits. So everybody walked in and said, what is that pack? So learn in life that to differentiate, don't get carried away by listening to people. Go with your gut feel. Go with intuition. And the important thing, of course, my board said, are you going to launch Tiger? And I spent a lot of money behind it. So, but I said, they said, look, you're actually going in for a high margin, low volume game. You're going to kill the company in case Tiger is not successful. So I said, all right, I convinced my board. Let me test market. Now the board said, okay, go ahead and test market. Utna to influence chalta tha. But what I decided to do was, which I didn't tell the board, I had to show high volumes. Otherwise, the game was gone. So I test marketed and my test market was one in each state in India. So 29 markets launched Tiger at the same time. Now, if it failed, I would have lost. I would have got sacked. But it succeeded. Now, when you ask, it's a good Punjabi intuition that you follow. So for a brand, you might read everything. And remember, another good thing about a brand and people, when you come in, look, the difference is very little between marketing a person and marketing a product, except that you have to convince a team that thinks differently without highlighting the weaknesses of the person. Now, the nation at that time wanted a person who was honest, who was hardworking, and he came with anybody supporting him, like the Nehru family or anyone. That is what the nation wanted. And these were the three qualities that were there in the person. So you go ahead and you bang that into the head of everybody that, look, this is what you want. This is the person that you want. This is now what he's done and where he's gone. We'll get into another debate altogether. But at that time, it was the person. And he had to fight a lot of people within. Huh? There was Lal Krishna Advani. I don't mind mentioning him. There was Sushma Swaraj. Yes. There were senior leaders. But they would have done the same thing that the party was doing. It was all going to be incremental changes. Here was a person who was not going to do incremental. Here was a person you had to present to him. And there you went and marketed it. Because let me tell you, the debate that took place was huge. The line that Ab Ki Baar Modi Sarkar was brought in by Piyush Pandey and me, sitting down over tea at about 7 a.m. to 9 a.m. And then we went into the meeting to present what we thought was the idea. And there were many others presenting. Piyush and I fought like mad, saying that nobody knows BJP at this stage. Today, if you want to say it, it's different. But at that time, BJP had only 2 seats or was not known, nor was that symbol of the lotus known. Nothing. So we worked on it. And then we finally said that, look, I mean, we went up to Jetty and said, let us go home. This was in Delhi. We've said what we had to say. It's for you to decide. He said, just wait for one more day. And the next day, of course, Amit Shah came in and he said, I don't know marketing, but ab ki baar Modi Sarkar. Then everybody said yes. After that, this was it. You know, so that's when you market a person, don't think Shah Rukh Khan is a brand ever. Each person stands for something that makes the brand. The individual will be forgotten. Yes. Except perhaps Mahatma Gandhi, or you know, you will, when I say that everything, there will be an exception. But the individual will be forgotten, not what he stands for. That is the most important when you market a person, you know, as opposed to a product.
Acha, Sunil, there are a few more questions coming in. One, of course, your ITC stint, you know, straight out of your college.
I am, yeah.
One of the questions is, what was your immediate learnings or paradigm shift, you know, from college to your first job? And there are a lot of youngsters on this call. So
you know, I went to give a talk to IIM Calcutta maybe about 10 years ago. Mm-hmm. And it was packed. It was about 7 o'clock. I didn't expect students to come up at 7 p.m. But the new auditorium in Joka now, we were earlier in another place altogether, which had a small place. But there were 200 students. And one of the students asked me the same question. Sir, what did you learn the first thing when you stepped out? And let me tell you, all I said was at that time, because we have IIM Calcutta was a very quantitative thing and very into all kinds of quantitative analysis. So I said, remember one thing, DYDX doesn't mean anything. That's, and it got a huge lot of applause, because what you learn is that, look, it's IIMs are a stepping stone to get into place, because they think that in 2 years you have learned or you've been exposed to a number of things. Now, what do you do with it when you get into an organization? Is the first thing, you've got to listen to experience, which very few of us tend to do. A salesman who's been there for 25 years, he has a lot to teach. So before you open your mouth, learn from them, and then try and convince your boss, which is a great learning for me, that the idea that you're presenting is his idea. Then and only then will you get it. Otherwise, if you come as a bright kid, and they suno, maine bola hai ye wo, hawa khao, that boss will kill you first. Generally, I'm making a general statement. Therefore, learn to listen and learn to make others feel that they are part of the decision or part of your idea. Don't say it's my idea and my idea alone. Tiger was made because the whole team agreed. I mean, ultimately, people might give it to you, but ultimately, that's a great learning which I would tell all the kids. Do not think you know everything. Do not think that just because you've come out of IIM, you've got a high salary, you have to get everything. If you want to make it in life, you will for 1 year. But after that, hawa khao. You'll be in one corner.
Another interesting question, you know, the kind of times we are going through, you know, these COVID-19 times, there is a lot of upheaval. And the question is, how about sustainability? What would you suggest to governments, and especially in a country like India, where there's a big disparity in India?
You know, yeah, okay. You know, the government, I think, is doing its best, but what they've done in the economic front, you expect that people will be now, sooner or later, you'll have to learn to live with COVID. There's no way. They haven't found a vaccine for dengue as yet. They haven't found a vaccine for HIV. Mm-hmm. So sooner or later, a cure will come out. So therefore, say by the end of the year, you will have a cure. So if you get COVID, you don't have to worry about it, because there is a cure. Like tuberculosis at that time killed you till antibiotics came. Now, TB is all right. You live with it. Yeah, take antibiotics, stay at home for 2 weeks, you'll be okay. So learn that, look, you have to start thinking that, look, the government must start thinking today. And I keep telling them that look, they've swung their benefits too much to the supply side. A little bit of balance is required on the demand side. And that's what I keep advising them, because without demand is the oil in the engine that is required, you know. Otherwise, the engine will freeze very soon. And the same guys you are giving money to will come back and say, I'm not producing because there's no demand for my products. So therefore, put some money into the hands of the consumer. And I say this only for this year, because it's not cast in stone. Give them some money. Incentivize them to spend. How will you incentivize them to spend? There are many ideas. Tell them if they buy a fridge, tell them if they buy a car, 50% of what you spend will be deducted from whatever tax you owe. So they will start spending on items like this. I'm just thinking out of the box. You cannot just make incremental changes anymore. And then next year, bring it back. Bring all your taxes back. Forget fiscal deficit. I'm just highlighting this thing of managing fiscal deficit And you know, all the companies that you're asking them to take loans, go ahead and take it. Ultimately, you're just making leveraging your balance sheet. Ultimately, the demand is the only thing that you will look for.
Another interesting question which is coming out is that, you know, in the new digital era, you know, there are a lot of apps and social media platforms. Why is it that in India, we've not been able to create a brand like Microsoft or Facebook or even TikTok, which has become so popular in India?
No, but actually, if you look at the youngsters, they are full of ideas today. Mm-hmm. OYO is created in India. Why are you looking at OYO? There are many things which don't latch on to, like, say, the ones abroad. And even for cars, they're aggregating. But the important thing that why haven't we thought of is that this comfort level that we get into, you know, that, all right, we are the supplier. Even Infosys and everybody else becomes the supplier of IT. You are the IT guys. So all the brains that are required to do what they do, you tend to get in this area of comfort and your focus changes. So once that focus is removed, you will watch that this is the time when a lot of people will come up with a lot of ideas and they will move on. And that's all that I can tell everybody. This is the only reason. Is not that why are number ones of all companies abroad Indians? Ultimately, they've gone there and what have they done? So I think sooner than later, maybe next year, a lot of youngsters are coming up with brilliant ideas on dealing with problems as opposed to just being part of it.
Absolutely. I think, Sunil, your message is resonating with the audience. I see a lot of compliments coming in. One says, wonderful thought process with strong belief and conviction. Highly impressive. Thank you, Sunil. I think good.
Thank you. I'll get Maya now. Ask her whatever you want to ask her if there's still a few minutes left.
Certainly. Absolutely. There is Maya. Some time and would love to have her on the call. Let's put this on. Maya, good morning. Good to have you with us. Thank you so much for joining.
Good morning. How are you, people?
Absolutely fine.
Always a pleasure to be with you guys.
Thank you so much for joining us. But listen, knowing that we have only little time left, I have two or three very questions which I wanted to pose more than the audience. I'm sure I'll
give
more questions for you. The first is, you've been a doctor, then a model, then an actor. How do you manage all this? These are major transitions.
You know, the transition came slowly. I mean, I was doctor and model for quite a while. I mean, almost 5-10 years. But it was all a question of managing time. I think, you go to work at 9 o'clock in the morning, you come back at 1, you then go to shoot your ad or whatever at between 2, and then you come home, then you see about the house. Over weekends, you shoot a film. But I think in all this, the ones who got neglected terribly were my children. I hardly had any time for them, really. I mean, I'm making a confession. They grew up well enough, but, even now they feel that, mommy, you didn't give us time.
Oh.
So I'm making up with my granddaughter.
Yes, I know that. And I see the priorities that you're giving. The other thing, of course, Sunil today was sharing his story and how twice he had these challenges in Britannia. Must have been a very trying for you. How did you manage?
Oh, it was very trying. It was very trying, and I must say it was very traumatic. The first time, we didn't involve the children at all. Anjori was too young, and maybe if she realized, she never let on. But Savri was sent away to boarding before that, so we didn't have to worry about her. But Sunil would come home dejected, somehow in my heart, Vimal, I knew that, I don't know how I knew this, I said, Sunil, stick on, because the minute you leave, they'll throw everything at you, ki tumne chori kiya hai, ye kiya hai, wo kiya hai. So don't accept it, go, get sacked, it doesn't matter, Danone is looking after us. And even if they weren't, we would still be all right. I said, theek rahega. And I had security guards sitting inside my house because I was scared. Bangalore ke ghar ke में हमारे नौकरों को बाहर निकाल दिया एंड दे वर स्टैंडिंग अंडर अ ट्री व्हेन आई वेंट टू बैंगलोर एंड आई सेड कि दे विल डू द सेम ओवर देयर एंड देन आई जस्ट यू नो and somehow I knew and would you believe it that I said Sunil we are in the right you haven't done anything wrong and we will win this war so let's just go and battle it out and I don't know I think maybe if you're in the right and you have so much faith in yourself and what you have done then somehow it works for you in your favor and to the date September 1st the trial started and ended with Sunil coming back in Britannia to the date September 1st. I still remember that. So very traumatic, but they chased us. They had it was really bad. They cut off our electricity. They cut off our telephones. They cut off everything. Gaadi le li wapas. Sab kuch bhi nahi tha hamare paas. Kuch nahi tha.
Really trying times. Tell me, through all this, what message would you like to share with there are a lot of people in the audience through all this, or what gives you the strength and the conviction to do what you did, and what message would you like to leave with some of the youngsters?
I think, you know, there's a lot that you're born with and you're brought up with that helps a lot. Because I have enough steel in my spine, as I should say, that my mother
steel
and father
in the spine.
My mother and father were in the INA, Netaji's INA, and they lost the battle, as you know, Netaji lost the battle, and they came back as absolute paupers to India. Papa was in jail for 6 months, as you know, the INA trials were lasted about a year. And mummy, of course, had escaped from Singapore after the INA stint because the women and children were told to run away. And she had put up with so much more than I ever could. And I just used to think of my mother and say, ki, you know, come on, she was a prisoner in a Japanese camp and she put up with that. And I can't take this. Of course I can. And that made me very strong.
So those experiences kind of built that spine of steel, as you say.
Yeah, and you know, everybody's life is going to be an up and down. It's not as if you're going to have, you're not born in the Gandhi Parivar, so let me leave it at that. But everybody else is going to have a rough time, sometime or the other in their lives. Bad, sometimes it's going to be really bad or sometimes not so bad, but hoega. Just bear it and say ki nahi ye theek ho jayega, this will pass and it does.
Yes, it does. Now we are in the last 5 minutes. Is it possible to get Sunil also so that I can ask both of you some questions together?
Come. They want us together.
Okay.
Yeah, tell.
This Polo, is lovely.
We are together.
Perfect.
Yeah, tell me.
You make for a lovely picture, actually, this way. Sharing the headphones. Question, Sunil. You and Maya, of course, you've achieved a lot. You've accomplished a lot. I'm sure you're very satisfied with the way things are moving. What next? Been there, done that. What next?
See, the next, as far as, let Maya answer her way, but I'm answering, look, as long as the family is together, what next will also take care of itself. This is the most important thing that one has to learn. And what next is that, look, I didn't think when I left Britannia, what next? Along came this thing of being a consultant. Now again, be a little more flexible. I've become a mentor now. It's gradually, look, consultancy you will have to become a mentor to people because as you get older and you become a mentor and that's a new phase for me. How do you mentor CEOs? How do you mentor youngsters who are getting to talk about their dad? The dad is not listening or his brother is not listening. And, you know, then the mentor and relationship is only between you and the CEO or whatever it is. You don't talk about it to anyone. But you exchange, think that this is what you think you would have done if you were in the same place. So your life changes. It gives opportunities. And maybe till the only thing I hope for is till the day I die, you die in your boots, yeah. You keep doing something. What will kill you is when you're doing nothing. And that's what I look at as the future. And Maya can say the whatever she has to say.
Well, you know, I'm looking forward to a very peaceful life. I've given the best education we could to our children. Uh-huh. And now it's their life and they have to manage. Right. Except my thing is that my granddaughter, what I couldn't spend with my children, I'm spending time with my granddaughter. And I also feel that, you know, I worked for 35 years in two separate industries, well, if you call that an industry, as a doc and as an actress, where there was no such thing as a Sunday. There was no such thing as going back home at 6 o'clock.
True.
You were working day and night. Now, I don't want to work anymore. Everybody keeps asking me, aren't you going to work, Maya? Aren't you missing it? I'm not. I just want to work. And read my books and watch my TV. That's it. And my granddaughter, whom I'm teaching a lot of Sanskrit shlokas to, and you know, what I couldn't teach my children, I'm teaching my children, my granddaughter.
That is wonderful. I think very well said. And I think you have lived immensely public lives, I must say. And I'm just you're in the last 2 minutes, and I just am trying to wrap it up. Thank you so much for your time, both of you. I think. Sunil, your message.
I will say one thing, Vimal.
Yes.
That
yes,
sometimes
please.
Maybe it's not such a good idea to be so public. Maybe it's better to be in the quieter life where, you know, you don't get written about in the papers when the times are bad. Nobody writes when times are good. They all write when times are bad.
Yeah, I guess that is also true. And maybe that's a commentary on our times. That you know, these kind of bad stories sell more than good stories, I think. In a way.
Well, in a way, I'm glad it's not happened in these times, because now with Twitter and Instagram and everything, I don't know how much people have got to channel.
Absolutely, I think it's been a thorough joy for me, and I'm sure for all the audience. I see lot of comments. Coming through, excellent lessons. Thanks for sharing. Beautiful smiles. We feel so privileged to hear you together. I mean, this is one of those rare occasions. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for having us.
Really appreciate your time. But thank you so much. And for all the guests who joined us for this call, thank you so much for joining. Our next speaker will be announced shortly. It will, of course, be Prasad Kaifa from California, who's a transformational leader, and I'm sure you will enjoy that also. Thank you, Sunil and Maya. Really,
thank
bye,
you.
Bye, thank bye. Thanks.
Have fun with the grandchildren. Thank you.
Bye.
Bye. Bye. Thank you.